everybody. I'm Mike.
I'm Matt.
We are Armchair Directors.
Go ahead, punk. Transport my drugs over the border. I don't know. We're taking a look at Clint Eastwood's The Mule, which is new on Blu-ray and digital.
Clint's still going at it.
It's about an aging guy who starts to become a drug runner for a cartel to make some money. And it's Clint, who's very unassuming, you know, can fly under the radar because he's just an old guy
He's not old. He'd have to be 10 years younger to be just an old guy.
I'm just moving some pecans for some terrible pie, so don't mind me while I disguise the scent of drugs by rubbing air freshener in your dog's face.
Yeah. Is this the first Clint starring movie we've reviewed on the channel? Because we did The Sniper, American Sniper, which he directed but didn't appear in.
We've done like maybe a couple, you know. I don't think we have. We did the exclusive Patreon request of Firefox recently,
so we certainly did that.
But in terms of modern Clint, this might be one of the only ones that we've gotten to.
So this is, if you've seen a Clint Eastwood movie in the past 20 years, you know what you're going to get. I love Clint Eastwood movies of the past 20, 30, 50 years.
Yeah.
I love almost all Clint Eastwood movies. White Hunter, Black Heart, I got to give another try someday. But yeah, this is, it's such a Clint movie, a quiet little story. Even though it's about a guy running drugs for like a big drug cartel, he still manages to make it quiet, small, personal, the little quiet moments. There's a lot of, it's fun to watch Clint Eastwood make little commentaries about things that are silly to him, like the cell phone obsession. And it pops up here and there throughout the movie, but it's just, it's a thing, sorry. But the generation that came before cell phones and aren't addicted to cell phones, they use cell phones, you know, in moderation, I guess is the term. You use it for a few minutes, you put it down. An hour or two later, you use it for a few minutes, you put it down. But this thing of the cell phone being like fused to your hand and never leaving your hand, that's an addiction. Like, that's unhealthy.
Right.
And it's fun to see Clint, who's been so productive throughout his entire life, make these little observations and stuff. But the, you know, there's a bizarre aspect to this movie that it wouldn't have had 20 years ago if he had done this. Like, Unforgiven is a great movie because he did it when he did it. If he did Unforgiven today, it wouldn't be quite the same because he's 90. So him being a drug mule at 90 years old, I'm constantly looking at him and going, like, I love this guy. He's one of my favorite actors and directors of all time, but he's so frail now. Like, his voice is so weak now. You know, he's got a curved spine. These aren't performance things. He is such an inspiration to me that he can do all this at the age of 90. But watching the movie, I'm like, you know, if we jump right to the end, we won't spoil anything, but he does something like that he obviously wouldn't be able to do at his age. If you know what I'm talking about, you know, he is able to do some physical feat that is, they don't show you, but they allude to it. And I was like, come on. They didn't cut away because, you know, we don't want to show you what happened. They cut away because I can't do what I need to do, you know, for this scene. So, you know, that was, other than that, like the movie magic that made this guy able to do things he wouldn't actually be able to do in real life. He wouldn't be able to drive or whatever that is, 12-hour, 24-hour drive. 90-year-old man, or at least this particular character, wouldn't be able to do it.
Yeah.
But, you know, hey, it's movie magic. Quit your griping, punk.
Now I will be honest with you. I did not like this movie very much at all. And I felt that it was, like, super long, really long, very boring in sections. And I don't mind when Clint makes these observations about the next generation and people being on their phones. But there was so many moments of this movie where I'm like, this feels like Dirty Old Man wrote a movie to be a dirty old man in, where the camera is oogling all these women at these parties, and like, I'm like, this is like a really long shot of a girl's ass grinding on Clint for no reason. Clint has a three-way in this movie. Yeah, like, 90-year-old has a three-way with like two really hot women. I start to be like, this guy wrote and directed this thing, and did he just do it to get his rocks off on the set? Like, part of me started to wonder where the line was. Like, it was just, it was really bizarre, but I like a lot of it.
I just to answer that particular scene, that was, you know, it was what it was, but I thought, well, we're seeing the descent, because there's a clear message, a very simple message. There's no reading between the lines in this movie. This is a 1983 Clint movie. Like, yeah. This is before the Oscars started coming in, you know, and there was a period there where they were calling Clint, you know, even as recent as American Sniper, you know, this visionary, great, amazing, gifted director, and he is. But they didn't always call him that. When he was doing movies like Sudden Impact, you know, Dirty Harry, the Deadpool, they weren't calling him a genius. It wasn't until he did, you know, Unforgiven and started doing that type of stuff. But this is like an 83. This is like, you know, not too far removed from Firefox or the Iger Sanction or some of those earlier Clint movies. And he's showing, I thought, look at this guy. He got some money. He's helping his friends. He's doing good. Now he's pulled in. Now he needs the money to help his family and friends. And now when you got too much money, he's being just corrupted. It's, well, just as simple as that. He got corrupted, and a good man got turned into a sleaze bag because too much money.
And I get that, you know, in a dribble movie like this, you want to show the excess and the living large that leads to the bad decisions and stuff.
And it's quick.
But
it's quick. I agree with you. It's too quick, maybe.
But as like a 90-year-old man, it's just like, what? And for me, I like all the stuff with Bradley Cooper and Michael Pena sort of as the agents, and especially Bradley Cooper's scenes with Clint were like the strongest part of the movie for me. And I really like that. And I don't mind the drug story, but sometimes I'm starting to wonder, you know, if we're really pushing the believability where the head of the cartel, Andy Garcia, is like, we got this great 90-year-old drug mule. I got to meet him. And it's like, yeah. Why? You aren't in any sort of risk of being caught until he's like, I got to meet this guy. And I'm like, but I don't think drug cartel would really need to meet the 90-year-old mule and wine and dine him when everything's working out well. And that's the downfall of the movie, is that they have this meeting and then things start to go bad. And you're just like, it felt like such a movie moment that I didn't buy. Like, it was like, just because we need to have A, B, C, D happen, this happened. And
that's a totally like an 83 Clint movie.
Yeah, well, thing you're right. Like, if this was
it,
like,
has to happen because it's Clint.
Yeah, if
it's
this was an 83 movie and it was 1983 Clint, I probably would have gone with it. And again, maybe it's just the cynic in me. Every scene with him and Diane Weiss just had me cringing. I was like, oh, I hate the writing of all of these scenes. Everything they're saying to each other, I just can't stand. So there was parts of this that I did like, and like I said, the Bradley Cooper Clint stuff is the best stuff for me. But the rest, yeah. I was just like, man, this movie is 25 years too late and a buck short.
Yeah. And as much as I love Clint, that there were, you know, a lot of parts where I thought, what if he had directed it, but if he had cast a 70-year-old in the role, and because he's 90 and he's playing 90, right? He might be playing 95. I don't know.
And I think, you know, it maybe is just one of those things where, you know, this is supposed to be like kind of like Clint's swan song, right?
Like, he's had like 10 swan songs.
He has. But a couple months ago, Robert Redford did Old Man and the Gun. That was his like crime swan song. And I love that movie. So putting this on, I'm like, yeah, this is going to be Clint's Old Man and the Gun. And I was like, oh, not even close.
Yeah, Grant, you know, as far as swan song, Gran Torino is it.
Yeah. Right?
That's Clint's swan song. And this whole thing of, you know, I want to go out on top. I like that Clint Eastwood said, screw it, I want to keep busy. So my hat's off to him. I admire him for not wanting to be that guy of, I don't want to ruin Gran Torino. That's the perfect final performance. I'm glad he went, I'm bored. I want to do something. So he made a little movie that doesn't matter,
right,
called The Mule. Yeah. So, and I was fine with it. I really appreciated being able to see Clint in a role again, because the trouble with the curve, I mean, it was okay, but
yeah.
You know, like, for all of its weak parts in this movie, I thought it was great to be able to see Clint starring again and acting alongside his real life daughter too.
Yeah, that was interesting, and I do like seeing Clint on screen. I just feel where he used to feel like a visionary director, I feel like now he's just like a, we got it, it's good enough, move on.
He's always been like that.
And especially when you watch some of these movies, though, where like certain scenes, I'm like, you're telling me they couldn't have got that better if they had done it again and again? And especially if you double feature this with the other movie he made last year, 1517 to Paris, that was god awful, just horrible. It really shows to me like his decline as a filmmaker, which I wish that he had stopped at Gran Torino.
See, I don't see it as a decline, though.
Sniper.
Gran Torino is an Oscar-winning movie, isn't it? Did it win something?
It might have. And it's another movie that when Million you realize Dollar Baby. How many non-actors are in Gran Torino, you're like, oy.
Yeah, that's exactly what I'm talking about. So when everyone else was going, wow, I was sitting there going, this is like 83 Clint. You know, like, he's polished a few things, but he's still 83. He's still Josie Wales Clint. Like, I think a lot of smoke was being blown up his butt. There was definite period where they started to talk to him, and they did it with Spielberg too. Right, there was a period where they were talking about Spielberg as this great Kubrickian visionary. Spielberg isn't that, you know. Like, he might have been able to do a few movies like that, but that's not his essence, and that's not Clint's essence. So Clint got lucky because a few people, you know, really high level actors and cinematographers wanted to work with him, and it really increased the look of the movies that he was doing. But they're still Clint movies, you know. They weren't that different from what he was doing in the 80s. And I guess because I love those 80s movies so much, I don't see the decline. Right. I just see, like, this is Escape from Alcatraz, even though I don't think he directed that one, but it's totally like 70s, 80s style Clint. So I'm able to just kind of comfortably ease back into that.
Yeah.
Whereas everyone else is like, where's the brilliance? And I'm sitting there going, there was never brilliance. It wasn't artistic brilliance. It was raw. You know, it was draw you in. It was genuine, just fun, easygoing, little stories that didn't matter all that much. So yeah, it worked for me.
Okay, let's do best part.
Worst part.
Best part, Bradley Cooper. Worst part, Clint oogling all the women and having three ways and the hell.
So worst part for me, yeah, is that stuff too, but not because it made me uncomfortable, but because worst part in the sense that, you know, a good man gets corrupted, and that's sad to see. It's a warning of something. Things always start innocently, right? It's like, talk to drug addicts. How did it start? Well, on the schoolyard, someone said, just try it. It's not a big deal. It's free. So innocent. And that's how it starts in this movie too. Right, just go deliver the thing, don't look at it, and no questions asked, and that's it. Mm-hmm. And here's all the money, and it's just so innocent, and you just keep going and going. And it was, you know, ham-fisted and quick, but he's such an upstanding, old-fashioned Korean War vet, and just to act like a total slime bag like within 20 minutes. It's like, oh man, that sucks. But he does man up at the end, and I'll go with best part at the end is that he does man up and he takes his comeuppance. I don't want to really spoil this. I want this to be a sort of spoiler-free review, but it was refreshing that he came out of that kind of sliminess and he was reminded of who he really is. And he knows if you... I dare say if you do the crime, you do the time. So I enjoyed that. About Bradley Cooper, you enjoyed his performance. I noticed, was he able to say a single thing in this movie without croaking? Because every single one of his lines sounded like he was talking like this. Like, every Bradley Cooper line in this It's all a big croak.
I didn't notice it.
We were about halfway through the movie. It's a good thing I wasn't watching it with you, because we were about, my wife and I were halfway through the movie, and he's saying cool lines, and he's being cool Bradley Cooper, but he's saying them all like this. And, you know, if you blah, 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 it'd be a smart idea if you listen to what we're saying. And so, and I mentioned this, do you notice that he's croaking every line? And my wife is like, yes, he is.
I think it's because he filmed this movie 2 weeks after he wrapped A Star Is Born and his voice was shredded.
That's what happened.
Because he literally went from Star Is Born to just doing this as a favor to Clint. And I'm pretty sure that his voice was wrecked.
Yeah, well, they should have brought Sam Elliott in to dub Brad Cooper's lines.
Because I didn't notice it at the time, but if I ever watch The Mule again, which is a very slim chance that I will, I may notice it now.
Well, that's The Mule. I thought it was a fun movie. Let's say out of $10, I'd pay $7 because I love Clint, and I'm really appreciative that I got to see him one more time, because when you're that age... You know, I mean, it doesn't matter what age you are. Tomorrow's never promised. But yeah. When you're at that age, you're, you know, tomorrows are even less promised. So I just am very grateful that I got to see another Clint starring role. So yeah. $7 out of $10 for me and for you.
$3.50.
Oh, very good. That gets you some nice flowers.
There you go.
Which we forgot to mention. Clint is a flower guy, a gardening guy in this movie. So he is a war vet, but he's mostly a flower guy, so don't go in expecting a retired Harry Callahan.
Right.
No,
right.
He likes to work in his garden.
He's got a certain set of skills, but it's not the skills you were hoping they would be.
He's a little bit of a dandy. So again, that's another thing that, you know, longtime Clint fans will be like, what? But yeah, it's check it out. I, you know, decide for yourself.
Absolutely.
And leave what you think in the comments below. Thanks a lot for watching, and until next time,
enjoy the show.